It is a great day in the Lord to be here and to worship Him together with family and friends and under the roof of God's protection. And I ask you to stand and receive God's greeting. Why is it so important to know that God has His protection over us? Why is it so important to know that we are His? Well, in Psalm 24, David says this, that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. That's us. He founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in His holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart. The one who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. God welcomes us with these words of power for us to remind us that we are His and He is ours. We can take that worship and welcome to worship this morning as we move forward into our time of praise and worship.
Change my heart, oh God. You are Lord. Amen. As Ronnie gets the screen back, here we go.
We'll continue in a way with praising God by reciting what we believe. When we recite our faith, you know, it's us taking that ownership of our faith and how we feel. We'll talk a little bit in the sermon about having an allegiance. You know, when we praise God, it shows our allegiance to Him. And when we recite our faith publicly, it shows our allegiance to Him. So I invite you to read with me. This is from a testimony from, it's called Our World Belongs to God. And this part talks about Jesus Christ standing in our place.
Jesus suffered during His years on earth, especially in the tortures of the cross. He carried God's judgment on our sins. His sacrifice removed our guilt. God raised Him from the dead. He walked out of the grave. Conqueror of sin and death, Lord of life, we are set right with God, given new life, and called to walk with Him in freedom from sin's dominion.
Being both divine and human, Jesus is the only
He alone paid the debt for our sin. There is no other Savior. We are chosen in Christ to become like Him in every way. God's electing love sustains our hope. God's grace is free to save sinners who offer nothing but the need for mercy. Jesus ascended in triumph, raising our humanity to the heavenly throne. All authority, glory, and sovereign power are given to Him. There He hears our prayers and pleads our cause before the Father. Blessed are all who take refuge in Him.
Amen. You can have a seat. The kids are invited to follow Miss Brenda in the back for Sunday school. Children's worship. This is in the open, but yeah, if you want to go. We have time to go to God with our prayers now. God listens to us. God wants to have a relationship with us that is open to conversation. And it's open in a way that, you know, we talk and He listens, but then again, He talks and we listen as well. And when we go to God in prayer with that attitude in our hearts, we can certainly have that back and forth conversation. And so that's why prayer is so important. Does anybody have any prayer requests? Tom?
Tomorrow for Dad's birthday.
Oh. 77?
No.
Almost 50.
Nice. Cool.
You know, a little bird told me that it's John's birthday tomorrow, too. Right, John? Yeah. Who's yours, bro, too? Are we singing happy birthday while we're at
it? I think we are.
No? I don't know. Do you have a choice in that?
No.
Anybody else? Yes, please.
I would like prayers for our community and for our country with the upcoming election. I just pray that people come together for what's best for the nation and not let the election divide them and divide families. And prayers for our community to continue growing and healing from COVID.
Don't let churches be divided either by politics as well, right?
Amen.
Thank you. Anybody else? Ready?
our 31-year-old friend David and a quarterback.
Is he, what is his status?
I'm not sure about that.
Okay. Oh, that actually reminds me, hang on, I found out yesterday that a member of Randy's house, which is an addiction recovery program, that the men's house and the women's house are right down there by Brooks Park. I found out he, well, they didn't say the words, but and this is, when I was still at Love, I had a relationship with a lot of these guys and gals that would come in and volunteer, and this was a guy who graduated from the addiction program, was set to go back home, went back home, and found nothing but dark places to find himself in. So, you talk about friends having heart attacks. He was a friend of mine. I considered him a friend. Even though he went back to Lansing, you know, with Facebook, you still keep up with him and everything. So, I just kind of want to, Brittany, you reminded me just with that, the Randy's house folks. In fact, the women's house a couple of weeks ago had a gal who was still in the program. And actually, she was new to the program. And she committed suicide over by the highway. And, you know, so it's just one of those things that, I just kind of want to add the Randy's house. Thank you. I was wondering if I was allowed to.
I'm still learning.
Learning. So, Randy's house folks, both. The folks that are still in the program and those getting out, because they're really happy and they're really charged up to get out, and I'm going back home, and then it just goes all south. So we just remember that. Cindy, did you have your hand up?
Yes. That's really what COPD. And for my son, he said I have five questions.
Okay.
Good. We were blessed to be able to watch two of our grandsons this week play football. And they both lost, but it was a great game. I got a video of Carter doing a touchdown. And Cash played for his very first time yesterday, and it took 5-6 minutes to take him down to the ground.
It's awesome.
He would just carry you along with him.
Right. I saw that on Facebook that you got a chance to see him, and I was happy for you because it's like a little bit more normal seeing him.
Yeah, we went to Cedar Springs yesterday, different school, different rules. There was no 2-foot spectators like the Greenberg, the past, our temple, women.
That's cool.
It was great.
Yeah.
Nice. We went to the big temple and had
Okay.
Only two spectators per kid.
Okay.
Well, we got the mom and dad, and then
who else? Yeah. Right. Cool. No, I was happy for him. I thought it was cool. I mean, we completely missed the baseball season. Mm-hmm. Grandkids playing football. Jesus Christ. Very cool. Anyway, Sam.
A few weeks back, his father was diagnosed
with
amyloidosis. Is it pronouncing it?
Say it again.
Amyloidosis.
Okay.
I think they're still figuring out where he is, where it is, and what type it is. Traditionally, like expectancy is 1-5, one type is 7-12, the other. The hope for healing.
Yeah.
And, easy.
Right. Yeah, certainly. Thank you.
Prayers for one of John's cousins and his wife. Yesterday afternoon they were in a motorcycle accident. They weren't wearing helmets, but Nikki said that they're doing okay.
They're on the evening.
Right after you guys left.
Really? Were they coming to your house?
No. They were somewhere driving around. I'm not exactly sure. Because It's my aunt's new husband's son.
Okay.
So, I don't know him.
Was that in Colton?
I'm not exactly.
They have a bike accident. I'm from.
Yeah, we saw that.
So, but I guess you're all right. End up a little bit.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
I had a broken collarbone and my mother.
Right. Thank you, Mike, and thanks for bringing that up. I think some of you may know how I feel about motorcycle accidents. So, being in one myself a couple of weeks ago and being still on the mend from it, but thanks for that. I didn't heard that. So. Alright. Anybody else? Brittany.
Another phrase that Miss Laura has been with us for a whole
year. You didn't mention her birthday when we talked about her birthday.
Oh,
hello.
Yeah,
all right.
All right.
Awesome. Thank you. Scott, you here?
Yeah. Springford, Wade is the province for all things for that three. The last time I'm there, I'm going to help them all.
Well, say the church name again.
It's the Baptist Church.
Because I'll be honest with you, I just got a First Baptist Church of Hoopy down here.
Well, I don't know if it's First Baptist Church.
All right. Thank you. Anybody else? Eric.
Continual prayers for your grandfather that gets saved before he passes and comfort through his cancer.
What's wrong with his name?
Dear.
Thank you. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your sovereign power to know that you are in control over all things. It says in Psalms that we read that you set the mountains in place and you created the world with your greatness and your ability, and we have this great mountain that you sit in front of us, and it's huge and it's powerful and it's scary, but we are told that with clean hands and pure hearts, we can climb that mountain and be with you. And even though we don't have a mountain here in Michigan that's worth climbing like that, you know, we do have those times in our lives that are huge mountains. They're huge obstacles in our way that we have to climb over every day. And that we know that with your power and your ability put in us through the power of the Holy Spirit and being adopted as your children through the salvation of Jesus Christ with our faith, that we know that, you know, we still may have to climb the mountains, but when we get to the top, we know it's going to be because you helped push us up there. You help motivate us constantly to not be scared of the mountain in front of us and to know that because of your power and your love for us, that mountain will be flat and it'll just be a a casual walk for us to make it up there. You know, this morning we have praises in our prayers. We have birthdays. We praise your name for Solera's first year birthday and for Bob and John and Eric's birthdays coming up. And we praise your name that you have given life. Every day you add to our numbers. Every day you give us this life and a birthday celebration. And we know it's for you. And we know it's your gracious power that you have our years and our days numbered, and that you give us those years to celebrate your greatness. You know, a celebration of a birthday celebrates a year of greatness a lot like coming to church on Sunday to celebrate the fact that we made it through another week. And we praise your name, the fact that we can make it through another week here in Newaygo and in the state of Michigan and through the United States of America. And we ask that you continue to motivate our community leaders and our church leaders as we work to do God-glorifying things in the communities that you've put us in. And for us as church members, that we do God-glorifying things as we help our neighbor, help our fellow church member, help our friends and family as we go through this time of division in the United States over who's going to make a good president or whose life matters most or who's entitled to making the decisions and making the rules in spite of the fact that sometimes they're terrible. So we ask, dear Lord, that you help us to make those God-glorifying decisions in our voting in the upcoming election. And we pray that you make the God-glorifying decisions come to the leaders that are elected and the leaders that are already in these positions of leadership, whether it be state, local, or federal, throughout the world, dear Lord. Because, you know, this whole world is connected right now with COVID. And each leader and each country and each person has to make these decisions that are right for their communities. You know, we ask for a blessing for the church worldwide that has to make those decisions for the communities that they're in. High in the way to see a Baptist church in the Philippines that Scott has had his heart tied to for several years now. And we pray for the pastor there and the community that they are able to do church and do service with what they have. But we also ask for a blessing on this church, dear Lord, to give them what they have. Bless them with the things they need to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ to that community, dear Lord. People need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ because the gospel of Jesus Christ is flat out all about love. And so we ask for prayers of love and healing for our loved ones, the friends and the family that we have in life. We pray for Jerry, who was fighting cancer, Amber's grandfather, but you know, at the same time, he's fighting Jesus. And we just ask in the powerful name of Jesus Christ that the Holy Spirit pricks Jerry's heart, turns him towards God and understanding what God is in his life and how God can be in his life, that it's just not the end. And there's greatness for him in Jesus' name. Dear Lord, we pray for John's cousin and wife who were in an accident last night. Cycle accidents are scary, especially if you've been in one. We praise your name that they were sustained and that they are alive. And we just ask for healing because not very many people walk away from a motorcycle accident without something that needs to be healed. And we hear they have broken collarbones and things like that. So we ask for healing on them, but you know, we praise your name that they were sustained because they weren't wearing helmets. And that's a huge part of motorcycle safety. But we know that you were there, dear Lord. We thank you so much for that. Dear Lord, we pray for Sam's dad with a diagnosis of amyloid or amyloidosis while they're trying to figure out which type it is. We just pray that in Jesus' name, you just take get rid of it. Then at the next meeting, they can't find it. Then at the next meeting, they don't have to worry about how long he has or the treatment that's going to go through because you can't do it. Lord, we pray for Cindy dealing with her COPD and having to go to a spine specialist. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask for just some peace and grace in her life. Help her breathing to become easier and her movement to become easier as they work to heal her. Again, we ask in Jesus' name just to heal the problem for them so that they don't have to worry about it. Dear Lord, we pray for Brittany Strand Taylor, who had a heart attack. We don't know much, and we'll look forward to knowing more in the future, but we pray for their healing hand on him. Jesus, heal him. You are the doctors that are taking care of him, dear Lord. Help him to get past his heart attack and become on the mend. Dear Lord, we pray for family members who are in rough spots. We have a sister that we're going to pray for, Linda, who is in a rough spot. She's dealing with things that would normally people wouldn't ask for. But you know, the world that we live in gives us these things. And so we ask for grace and peace. We need her with the power of the Holy Spirit to get through these rough patches, dear Lord. Help her know where the help comes from, and it's in your name. Dear Lord, I pray for my friends at the Rain's House and the men's and women's house who are dealing with addiction and dealing with rehabilitation and having to deal with stepping away from what chemicals or things in their life that they have made an idol and they worship, so to speak, and that they find the truth that they need while they're at Randy's house. But I also want to pray for the ones that are released. I pray for Brian Gernot's family, who are mourning his death now, and the fact that a lot of my friends and the folks that come out of Randy's house step into something very hard in life and very dark in life, and it's hard to make their way through life after rehab and after living in a structured housing setup so that they know how to at least work with their addiction, but they have to still go outside. I've learned this also with people getting released from the Department of Corrections, that the state gets them ready up until the point and then just drops them off, puts them on a bus and says, get out when it stops. So we pray for those folks that are still dealing with those struggles where they think they have it figured out, and then they're set free. And then they have to deal with things like that. Dear Lord, we pray for the grace that comes from you for a better life for these folks. Dear Lord, we pray that we are seeing better lives for all of us amidst this COVID virus, amidst the numbers that come out that Carol can tell us about, but how fun it was to go see her grandkids or grandboys play football, and that it felt, or at least to me, it felt like it was normal again to sit out and watch the kids play football. And you know, we just ask that more and more of those opportunities pop up for us. For Phil and Carol can go see the boys play football more and more, and each one of us gets an opportunity to just go out and feel that normalcy in this beautiful fall weather that you've given us. That we can go out and not be afraid of getting sick or not being able to go into a store because we left our mask at home, or not worrying about the person that's not wearing a mask that's sitting next to us. And that we know that you are in control always, and that we can feel that, like I said, moment of normalcy. We can have a peace in our lives about COVID and coronavirus or whatever you're doing. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for the peace you've given us. We thank you so much for the wisdom that we have and the guidance of the Holy Spirit and the risen Christ that paid the cost for our sins. And our sins are many. Our sins are as dark as the sky and as many as the stars, and Jesus paid the cost for us, dear Heavenly Father. We thank you for putting us in a time of worship here in our church building, and we ask for a blessing on the sermon and the message, and through reading of Scripture. Dear Heavenly Father, open our hearts. Lead and guide us through your wisdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is three verses out of Deuteronomy 5:7-10. We're going in through this series of the Ten Commandments. Last week we read, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. And then it picks up with verse 7, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I... That I is important. The Lord your God and a jealous God, punishing the children from the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. This is God's word reading for this morning. And like I said, you know, that I is important. We learned about last week how the I is important because God said, I am the Lord your God. Look at me. I'm the one talking. So when we see those I's as they go through the Ten Commandments, we'll remember that that's God talking, you know. We look at the reading in the Second Commandment today, and having no other gods except God is a hard one, right? The Second Commandment is one of those commandments that people break a lot. You know, I think I personally maybe break the Second Commandment innocently. I'm going to repeat that, innocently every day. I'm not bragging about it. I'm being real with you that having things in our lives that kind of take our attention away from God is a problem. And, you know, some people may understand my problem, and then some people may not, but I'm just telling you, remember, God loves me, so don't judge me too much. But, you know, some people see that the idol I may have in my garage is just a mode of transportation or a death trap, depending on who you look at, but I really, really love my motorcycle. I really do. I spent 2 weeks after I crashed it putting it back together just to load it on a trailer and go for a 4-hour ride on the east side of the state because I really, really love my motorcycle. Ask Rhonda how much I love my motorcycle. It's so choice. If you have the means, I suggest getting one. Bob, maybe for a rookie person. It's an amazing feeling to jump on it, turn it on, and turn the radio, feel the wind and the bugs hit your face. You know, you really do feel the freedom of the road on a motorcycle. And you meet the nicest people on a Honda. They've said that for years, and it's still true. I can't be fully to blame for my idolatry, though, because like Adam said to God in Genesis 3:11, the woman gave it to me. Thanks, Rhonda. But, you know, verses 7 through 10 in Deuteronomy 5 go hand in hand with verse 6 from last week. Remember that there, we talked about verse 6. You know, there's people that feel that verse 6 and 7 are the same commandment, and they go hand in hand, and others believe they are separate. I want to read them again. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. Now, if you take the period out of there and put a comma in there, they go hand in hand. But either way you cut it, the main purpose of verses 6 and 7 illustrate the importance of knowing the sovereignty of God. And not only just knowing the sovereignty of God, but knowing how to serve him with our lives. And knowing that because he's so sovereign, we need to serve him in our lives. Interestingly enough, in the Exodus story, when God was giving Moses the second commandment and the tablets were being written out, down below, in front of the mountain, the people were building something like this.
I'm getting there.
A golden calf. Why a golden calf? Why is this? Why? What's this first animal? You know, why the calf? Well, they just left Egypt, where they had experienced pagan god worship for 400 years. They knew generational idolatry, and they knew that when they were in Egypt and they saw the Egyptians worshiping whatever god they wanted to, that they saw success. So while they were waiting at the bottom of Mount Sinai, waiting for the success that God was going to bring them, they made a golden calf. And in Egyptian lore, is that the right word to use? In Egyptian belief, I guess, the golden calf is called Apis, A-P-I-S. The golden calf, Apis, was the golden calf of fertility and success. And I don't want to say good times, but good living, I guess. When the grounds are fertile, when the crops are fertile, you know, you get good food out of it. You know, when your wife is fertile, you get a family. So they built this golden calf. It was something that they were used to. They don't say that, well, let's just build. It doesn't say in the Exodus story that they said, well, let's build a golden calf because God's not working out for us. No, they wanted a golden, they wanted something in front of them because they couldn't go up to the mountain. And then they took Aaron, who was God, or Moses' right-hand man, and said, look, we built this golden calf. Let's worship it. So Aaron, thinking he knew what he was doing, he created something of a festival to the Lord. And so they worshiped this golden calf to honor God, which is a completely wrong idea, especially when God is telling Moses to write down, you shall have no other gods before me. So when Moses comes down the mountain to see what's going on, he sees the golden calf, and he's so mad and he's so angered, and God says, here's what you're going to do. You're going to take that bowl off the calf, pound it into powder, put it in the drinking water, and everybody that has worshipped it will drink the water. You can read about it in Exodus 32, but that's how bad it was. That's how long of a sin it was. I can't say very well if the people died, but I can only imagine drinking a large amount of gold powder in your water would probably kill you. That's how bad it was. God was killing them, and he was using the idol that they made to do it. You shall have no other gods before me as a strong command. Because there are absolutely no other gods that match up to God. Our God is the God above all gods. Our God is the King of kings and the Lord of lords, and it goes on from there. God knew what he was talking about when he said, you're not going to find a better God than me that loves you the way I do. It's actually kind of hard for a pastor to come up with what God was thinking in a scripture passage. I don't want to say something wrong. I don't want to assume what God is thinking. We probably shouldn't, but we can see, though, that through his word, we can see that God is requiring allegiance through us and from us, and we can take cues from scripture about how great our God is. Through the Old Testament, all the way through, we hear about Elijah and the prophets of Baal building an altar and having an altar contest, and Elijah says, pour more water on it, pour more water on it, pour more. The wood is soaked through. The wood on the altar is swollen because it's so much full of water. And they're like, you're never going to get it to light. And God sends down a lightning bolt. Boom! Lights that altar up. We see his greatness. We see the greatness all the way through scripture, how it worked through Jesus' people. When we did Ezra, we talked about how he brought them back to Jerusalem like he promised he did it for so many years. And then it culminates all the way up with the birth of Jesus Christ. God's greatness comes to us through the birth of Jesus Christ when the angel Gabriel tells Mary that he will be the Son of God, the Most High, a Son given to the world to save the world from its own sin. A God like that deserves 100% of our praise. Deserves 100% of our love. Deserves 100% of our lives and our allegiance. That's why it's so important to get rid of the gods that we have in life or keep them at bay and understand what could be a god, whatever they are. You know, I started this sermon joking when you're talking about my motorcycle. being an idol in my life, but all joking aside, we need to take caution because idols can be some of the most innocent things in our lives that start up simple. There are so many things that will stir us up with trouble and land us firmly on our backside because we failed. There are so many things in our lives that will separate us from our God. Jobs, relationships, drugs, alcohol, sex, performance, working out at the gym. Little things like that. In the life of every Christian, everything that happens in the world, from the acts of nations to the fates of the individuals, is ultimately under God's control. And so we need to focus on God and not the world. Amen?
Amen.
Thankfully, we have, as believers, we have the love of God that helps and works and moves through us and supports and protects us as we spend our time on this planet. God's infinite love and grace is coupled with his power and ability to work on our behalf. There is nothing on this planet that gives us the kind of life, not a boyfriend, not a girlfriend, a husband, a wife, not even a mother's love, that comes near to what God loves us for. I actually think that the love of a puppy probably comes close, but it's nowhere near. You know, when God knew that humanity was going to screw up, God knew that, people with this freedom of will to choose from right or wrong were going to go out into the world and find instant satisfaction apart from God. Some people can't wait for God's plan to pan out, so we're going to go out and find it. Just like Adam and Eve went out into the Garden of Eden, and God said, you got everything, and you've got me. You don't need anything else, but they wanted to look, and Satan deceived them, so they took the bite out of the apple from the tree that God said you shouldn't eat from. You shouldn't eat from it. And look what happened. They were expelled. Humanity was changed and that creation was broken. That's why in our reading today, God tells us that we can't use anything. In verse 8, in creation, even though God created it to find contentment and satisfaction apart from him, because he knows us more than we know ourselves. He knows we'll fail. He knows that there's no other God. We live in a my needs come first society right now. We think we deserve better things, better times, better situations. So at times we go out and look for things that are not God. Things that may seem innocent at first. Things that can grow into a demon on our back. Not finding a satisfactory idol in our life is easily fixed. I should say that again, not finding satisfaction in what God has given us is easily fixed with these idols that we find and temptations in the world that all they do is bring quick gratification. It's a band-aid on things, but the band-aid comes off and the real issue in our lives are still there. These false idols can make ourselves that we make for ourselves, they do nothing. They sit on the ground. They sit in your shelves, so to speak. They sit on a platform, and you know, it doesn't change. Like Elijah said, well, what about your God? Where is he? He's not doing it. Maybe he's asleep. Maybe he's out taking a walk. Maybe he's out. You know, idols and gods do nothing for us. We need to be prepared not to fall into this trap. Idols give us this false sense of security that's going to be a trap for us. When we stay strong to our allegiance to God, we stay safe and protected because God intensely loves us and intensely protects us. In verse 9, we see that God calls himself a jealous God. He wants our love. He's jealous for our attention. God wants and deserves a reciprocated love. Love that comes back to him. Like I said, in verse 9, he calls himself jealous. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sins of the parents of third and fourth generation. In other translations, the word zealous is used. And in the same Hebrew language, zealous, and jealous actually have the same root, the same word that they come from. God shows his character by being zealous for us and vigilantly guarding us from the sin and from the world because we are his. He gave life to us. He has a very great interest in seeing us succeed. I think parents with children can really understand that. You know, the earth was created in Genesis because God wanted a place to put people so that he could have a relationship with them, so that he could give them everything in the universe that they wanted for their lives. And so God, we see, jealously or zealously yearns for our relationship. Not only he desires that the Holy Spirit that he gave us stays strong. God does not want our spirits to be consumed by this world. The God of this world, the devil, is always trying to steal us. God wants a relationship with his children so that he can instill in us this good will, his good will within us. If this good relationship is established, he will guide us to a good and peaceful life. There is a difference, though, between God's zeal and human zeal. God's zeal, or even we could say God's jealousy for us as a future, there's hope in it for us. But human zeal is about one's own life. We get jealous about things we don't have. We get jealous about people who move up the ladder properly. So we have this jealousy that comes because we want earthly advantages or our own personal interests. But God's zeal drives us into this new life, where we're willing to give up our old life, our earthly life, our selfish life, to find life which is in Jesus Christ and that eternal life. Verse 9 and 10 are pretty hard to read, right? I mean, I just talked about how much God loves and desires us to be the only object of our idolatry. And then he says, but I'm going to punish you if you don't, to the third and fourth generation of the people that sin against you. I read and reread that passage, and I was trying to find the hook. I was trying to find the loophole, and then it's pretty basic, but I was hung up on it, because you still get this God that wants to love us, but guess what? If you screw up, you're not going to get me to love you. And I missed the big problem. So I opened up my MacArthur commentary, my handy-dandy MacArthur commentary, and it was easily explained to me, and I was like, how did I miss that? Idolatry, meaning worshiping a God other than Jehovah, works its way into our lives like a slime mold. Have you ever heard of a slime mold? I just watched a Nova documentary on slime mold. Go ahead and bring it up. Boom, slime mold. John, have you ever saw that 14 for stuff? It's not edible. That's what they said. Slime mold can be formed or found in the forest, on logs, on leaves, on rocks, on anything. It's a single-celled organism that doesn't have a brain. But it finds and works its way around different objects in the forest to find its new nutrients. Like I said, it doesn't have a brain, but it has this ability to work things out. It works things out according to experts by what's called fusion. It goes through its main purpose in its life is to find nutrients, right? So it will start out here. You see where it's a bigger mass, and it spreads out, and it fuses on things. It grows on things. It checks to see what is acceptable nutrients or not, and if it doesn't like it, it goes in a different direction. And then the rest of the slime mold kind of disappears because it dies off, and it crawls over things, and it works its way in to every crack and crevice of forest life, just like sin. Just like idolatry of the third and fourth generations. For these Israelites, future generations will just become used to the fact that they've got this idolatry in their life and that their parents said it's fine, it's okay. It's done on the festival of the Lord, so it's okay. and they'll go on. And so what happens is, as these generations continue to sin, they teach their children that that golden calf that we got on the shelf is okay, it's fine. What God will have to do is just go about business of punishing sin. There's no grace for it. There's no time for love because he's declaring a war on sin. His declaration of punishing the generations of the third and fourth generation is timeless because his word is timeless. For us, the punishment is the same as well. We run that risk. What does your golden calf look like? You don't need to answer. But what does your golden calf do for you in your life? My golden calf, my six-cylinder, two-wheel, two-tarmac ripping motorcycle does nothing for me right now because it's in pieces. But it still never did anything for me when it comes to the love of God. Golden calves exist in everybody's life. Everybody has to be on the lookout for them because it's not so easy to discern them. We must use that power of the Holy Spirit that God granted us every day and sometimes every hour to know that the devil is throwing stuff at us and we need to be aware of it. You know, I just bought a shirt at Walmart and people get a big kick out of it, but it says, "Not today, Jesus." And, you know, you can laugh at it, that's fine, but for me, or not today, what did I say? Not today, Jesus? Amber's laughing. It says, "Not today, Satan." Thank you. Thank you for laughing, Amber, that wouldn't make sense. But, you know, people chuckle at it, but I look at it when I wear that shirt, and I'm like, man, it's funny because my ears are open and my eyes are open. Satan uses idolatry in our lives to come in and steal our love from God, to kill our relationship with God, to divide the church from itself and from God. The devil attacks all the time with this idolatry, and I'm telling you, my friends, he is relentless. But God, on the other hand, is love. Amen?
Amen.
Verse 10 gives us this glimpse. This is the big answer that I should have gotten when I first read verse 9. Verse 10 gives us this big glimpse as to what God is saying. Verse 10 is kind of like when kids tell you they love you this much. I love you this much. You know, Pete used to do this, and then he would add a number to it because he couldn't get it big enough. I love you 90-10. You know? But that's what God is saying. But, you know, we get a glimpse at God because the love that he has for us ain't just this much. We can't do it, right? We can't reach our arms out. We can't know the love of God, but we can see it, and that it will last for 1,000 generations. Or no, it says thousands of generations. Think about your last family reunion. How many people were there? Now think about how many family reunions happen yearly in this country and then in this world. God's love is enough for your family reunion and for everybody else's, as long as they follow him. And the generations of Christians that came onto the scene after the church got started got this extra special gift of how big God's love is. That's what that means, right? Look what's behind me. John 3:16, 17 says that for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. And verse 17, because God didn't send his son to condemn the world, but to save it through him. I used the word idolatry in my sermon title. And according to the gospel, according to Webster's dictionary, the word idolatry can be defined as the same type of idolatry that we've talked about today. Serving a God other than our God. But it also means extreme adoration, extreme love, extreme reverence for something, we'll put that aside, or for someone. Our Heavenly Father should be the only object of our extreme admiration or adoration, love, and reverence, because we are the only object of His. I'm going to say that again. Our Heavenly Father should be the only object of our extreme admiration, love, and reverence, because we are the only object of His extreme admiration, love, or reverence. God gave us this commandment for our own good, because He knew that His children would lose their way from time to time, and that they would go away and they would find other things in their life to help serve them as God. And He did this so He will protect us, always protect us. Even if we're worshiping the wrong God, He will still get our attention. He will still get our love and our reverence back, because He is our God. He has this religious allegiance to us. Where does your allegiance? Where does your allegiance stand? We pledge allegiance to the flag, and I thank God that we have a pledge allegiance to the Christian flag, because the Christian flag reminds us of God's power. What God do you idolize in your life? Who's your idol? I think the American Idol TV show kind of coined that phrase. Who's your idol? Answer to that is that God idolizes us every day. Everybody say with me, thank you, God, for your allegiance to us. Thank you, God, for your allegiance to us. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you fight for us, and you are strong enough to fight the idols in our lives that would sooner see us dead and separate from you. Dear Heavenly Father, continue to bless us with the power and ability to know what an idol is in our life and how to get away from it. Dear Lord, help us to use that ability to get away from it also to help our family and our friends and our neighbors and the people that come to us wanting to know Jesus, to know what it means to worship the right God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. That song says it all, doesn't it? I mean, I could have taken the easy way out and just let Chris preach today. But, you know, that song is amazing. And our God is amazing. Our God will be with us through all things, protect us in all ways. And before I send you out with God's blessing, I forgot to mention that our offering will be collected as you exit the sanctuary today on the chair over there. So, with God's grace and power and sovereignty in your life, I send you now to go in peace, in the knowledge of that power. Go in confidence in the knowledge of God's strength, and go in joy and knowledge of God's love. Go in shalom.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures, hear me below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son,
amen.
Amen.